In this final session together, I want to raise theology. Everybody has a theology. Theology is what you think about God. But there are theological issues behind all that we've talked about so far. Two in particular. The first is the question of responsibility. Who is responsible for these four steps happening? Or who do you blame if they don't happen? Which is another way of putting it. There are three streams of theology through the last 2,000 years of church history. And they all have a very different answer to the question I've just put. First, there are those who believe that God is responsible for all four things, and He alone, and that He is to blame if they don't happen. The second stream says, no, man is responsible, and we must blame human beings when they don't happen. And the third, which is my own answer, is both. It's both God and man responsible for people coming into the kingdom. Well, now let me spell those out and mention some of the names of men in history who have been guilty of bringing these different views into the church. First of all, there are those who believe that God is responsible for everything. That He chooses us, that when He's chosen us, He leads us into repentance and faith, and that the whole thing is God from start to finish. This stream talks about the sovereign will of God, that He is almighty, He is in charge of everything, and therefore when these four things happen, He must make them happen. And all the responsibility is His. Now let me give you some of the names of people who have held this view. The first I want to mention is Augustine, way back in the 4th century. You must have heard of St. Augustine, I think. And he has influenced Protestants and Catholics. The second man I want to mention is Martin Luther, who also held this view. The third man is Calvin. And the fourth man, least known but most responsible for this view, is Theodore Beza, who was Calvin's successor in Geneva. Now these four men together have deeply planted the idea into the church, and it has been widely accepted by all who call themselves Reformed theologians. And ultimately, Beza was the man who crystallized it. Funnily enough, Martin Luther was a Calvinist, and Calvin wasn't. That's always confusing. Beza is the man responsible for out-and-out Calvinism. And he propounded the five ideas corresponding to the word tulip, T-U-L-I-P. And those five words came out of a synod of Dort in the Netherlands. And the Netherlands really accepted this. The five things are these. T, total depravity. That means a man can do nothing about his salvation. he is totally depraved. He's so far gone that only God can do anything about it. Second, unconditional election. That God has chosen us not because of anything at all in us. It is entirely his decision to save us, and we have no say in it whatever. We are unconditionally chosen, elected to be his people. Third, L, limited atonement. That is the belief that Christ died not for everybody, he died only for the sins of the elect, the chosen. Because, as they say, how can someone be punished twice for sins? And if Jesus has been punished for the sins of the elect, he hasn't been punished for the sins of the others. I is the most important one, irresistible grace. And this stream of Christians talks very freely about the grace of God as something that you cannot resist. And if grace has touched your life, you can do nothing about it but submit to it. God is sovereign. Probably that's the key one of the five. And the fifth P, perseverance of the saints. Or in very simple English, once saved, always saved. Which is not a phrase in my Bible, but these people talk as if it is. Mostly, those who accept this stream of teaching that God himself is responsible for all the salvation of people. On the whole, churches that believe that practice infant baptism because this for them is a supreme example of how God has chosen someone before they've even thought of him. And so they practice infant baptism. Now that's stream number one, and it's a very, very common stream. You'll encounter it in many Christians in England. The Church of England is officially mildly Calvinist in its 39 articles. It's not my position. I cannot teach a God who does all that without any reference to me. The second position is the opposite extreme, and that salvation is all due to the will of men, and what we do is the crucial thing. We're trying to answer the question, why isn't everybody saved? Why doesn't everybody go through these four steps? And the first answer was, well, God didn't choose everybody. And that's why so many are not saved. The second stream would say, the only reason why people are not saved is in them. They have not decided. And puts all the emphasis on human responsibility. The man who made this popular was a British man, a British monk called Pelagius, P-E-L-A-G-I-U-S. And Pelagius and Augustine were at daggers drawn. They attacked each other. Now, Pelagius was a British monk who went to live in Rome and was horrified by what he found there. Rome was the headquarters of the church. It was the center of Christianity in his day. And he found such corruption among the other monks there and among the Christian leaders that he was horrified. And he said the reason they're in such a state is their own fault. You can't blame God for it. It's their own fault. They are undisciplined. They are not in charge, in control of themselves. And so he developed a system of what I would call do-it-yourself salvation. And he would put the whole responsibility on human beings for not being saved. Very congenial to the British people, do-it-yourself salvation. It keeps our pride intact. We are responsible for ourselves. And if you choose to go to church, that's your choice. If you want to be saved, that's your taste. And so this was a reaction to Augustine and to this emphasis on the sovereign will of God being the decisive factor. So when we ask, why isn't everybody saved? First answer was, God decided that. And he chose some to be saved and some not to be. I find that a terrible picture of God. As if God is picking names out of a hat. As if it's arbitrary and very speculative. So then there was this reaction of Pelagius against Augustine. And even in their day, there were people in the middle, mainly in France. Augustine was in North Africa. Pelagius came from Britain to Rome. But the French were halfway between. And Augustine very naughtily called the French semi-Pelagian. And by using Pelagius' name against them, he tarred them with the same brush. And I think that's very unfortunate. So the third stream, in which I would put myself, are that both are responsible. God and man together. The divine takes the initiative, but the human decides to respond. It's not totally depraved. We can respond to the gospel and we can refuse. We can resist God's grace. It's not irresistible. And I believe it's both simply because both are mentioned in the New Testament. We are commanded to repent. God commands us to repent. And yet another verse will say, he grants us repentance. And it is this mixture of texts, some of which say God gives us these things, and some of which say we produce them. And the answer, I believe, lies in the fact that both are true. And the man who mainly injected this thought into the stream of church life was a Dutchman called Jacob Hermanszoon, the real Dutch name. But when he was a student in college, he changed his name to a Latin name. That was the custom of the time. And they each gave themselves a new identity in college. And he gave himself the name Arminius. And I'm sure that some of you at least have heard of him. and of what he stood for. And he stood for this cooperation between God and man, that there are things we have to do to make salvation possible, but there are things that God has done and is doing to make it possible. It's a question of cooperation. And that's where I basically stand. Though it's a minority position, alas. Let me try and picture it for you. I'm thinking of a man drowning at sea. And there are three people seeing him drift out to sea in the water. And one of them says there's nothing he can do. He's drowned. He's actually dead in the water. And if he's to be saved, someone has to dive in and pull him out and pump him dry. That's the Calvinist view. That's the view that God is in charge of our salvation. He has sent his Son to dive in and to pull us out and save us. And there is nothing we can do about it. We were dead in trespasses and sins. We were drowned. We were helpless. And it needed God to send someone to fish us out of the water and virtually give us the kiss of life and bring us back and thus save us. At the opposite end is a man like Pelagius, and he says the man is still alive, but he will drown. He's drifting out to sea. And what he needs to do is to swim to the shore. And so the second man on the shore is shouting to this man drowning, pull harder, swim harder, stretch for the shore, come this way, but you can do it. You can save yourself if you only set your mind to it. But that's not the truth either. I want you to consider a third possibility. The man is drowning and he's drifting out to sea. But the third man on the shore throws a rope to him and says, grab hold of this and I'll pull you to the shore and save you. And there has therefore been a cooperation from the man. He has needed to do something. He's needed to grab the rope and hold on until he's safely on the shore. But nobody could say he's saved himself. He was saved by the man who threw the rope. Call the rope the gospel, and you've got the third picture. And I believe that, as it were, the gospel is being thrown out to drowning people, and they're told, grab hold of it and be pulled to the shore. He doesn't do the pulling. He doesn't do the saving. And a man who's been pulled to the shore by grabbing hold of a rope will never say, I saved myself. He'll always save the man who threw the rope. He saved me. And all I did was grab the rope and hold on. That's my picture of salvation. We have been thrown a rope. The gospel has given us the chance to be saved. And we have grabbed hold of it and hung on until we got safely to the shore. Now, I hope that simple picture has given you the three streams in a very, perhaps an oversimple way. But those are the three main views of salvation that are being preached in the church today. That first view is the strongest, and yet it's being preached by children of the Protestant Reformation, because Luther and Calvin both held it. The left wing of the Reformation, as it's called, the Anabaptists, they were of the third view, not that first view. They were of the cooperative view, that it's cooperation between God and man that leads to salvation, both together. The big name in that third view of God and man cooperating was John Wesley and Charles Wesley. And he had a magazine for the early Methodists, which was called The Arminian. And Wesley and his brother were both Arminians in theology. And they therefore believed that the gospel was offered to people, and if they grabbed hold of the gospel and hung on to it, they would be pulled safely to the shore, or in other words, to heaven one day. And that is why Wesley was one of the very few evangelists who saw it as vitally important to follow up a decision in a crusade. And he had developed a system called the class meeting, and every convert that Wesley brought to the Lord, he put into a class meeting to see that he went on. George Whitfield was a contemporary evangelist with John Wesley, but he was of the first view, the Calvinist view. And George Whitfield was a great evangelist, particularly in America, very good at getting people started. But he said to Wesley, "Your work will last longer than mine because you followed it up and you keep building people up." Charles Wesley wrote a hymn, and it goes like this: "A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never-dying soul to save, and fitted for the sky." And it was fitting people for the sky that occupied both the Wesley brothers most of their time. And while it probably saved England from the French Revolution, historians seem agreed on that. Nevertheless, it was because he didn't just get decisions. He took them into a class meeting to see that they grew up and went on with the Lord. Well, I think that's the first thing I wanted to say. The word keep is interesting. Who does the keeping? Now, for the first view that God does it all, they all consistently teach one saved, always saved, and say it's God who keeps people up. It's God who causes them to persevere. Pelagius would say, no, it isn't. It's man who perseveres. But Arminius and Wesley would all say it's a cooperation between man and God. And that is why the word keep appears in two ways in the New Testament. Take the little letter of Jude, grossly ignored, but it's a wonderful letter. And it finishes up by saying two things. Number one, keep yourselves in the love of God. and two, because he is able to keep you from falling. Keep yourselves in the love of God, and he is able to keep you. They're the two sides. God keeps, but we have to keep it up. Both are needed. And the result is that a person is kept. When Paul came to the end of his ministry and his life, he said two things. He is able to keep what I've committed to him, and I have kept the faith. And this twofold emphasis goes all the way through the New Testament. He can keep me, I must keep in his love. Both will result in perseverance. Now, the idea that he is able to keep is all you need for perseverance is wrong. And the idea that all we need is our determination to keep, to be kept. It's both. And it's this double emphasis on the work of God and the work of man in salvation that is so important. I don't know if any of you will have any questions about that, but I think if you listen carefully to the preaching in your church, you'll find out which of those three views is being taught. And I believe if you're going to be true to the whole Bible, you will teach both, that God can keep you and that you need to keep yourself. And both go together. I believe that to say it's all of God and he'll do it all is an insult to human beings. We're made in the image of God. We're made capable of resisting him, of saying no to him. And to me, that's probably the crucial one of the five Calvinist beliefs that I find objectionable, the irresistibility of grace. Grace, I believe in grace. I believe in the initiative of grace. I believe that without grace, I can't be saved. But I also believe I can say no to God's grace and resist it and go on resisting it for the rest of my life. Well, now, I've been dealing there with a major theological discussion, which people have been discussing for centuries and will go on discussing. There is a real revival of Calvinism today, particularly in America, and a swing back from the overemphasis on human activity to an overemphasis on the divine. But if we preach the whole Bible, we will find ourselves in a balance between the two. Now, the other big theological issue that is raised, I've got a little diagram for you. I wonder if you can all see this. It's a very simple diagram. And here is our four divisions. R, B, B, R. Repent, believe, be baptized, and receive the Holy Spirit. That's what we've been talking about for the last four Saturdays. Now, what I've done is I've shaded this upper half as God's work in the four steps. And this bottom half, unshaded, as man's work. Now, the interesting thing is that in sheer number of texts on these four steps, there are only a few texts which say God grants repentance. There are many texts that say he commands repentance. So which is it? Does he grant it or does he command it of us? Well, the answer is, as far as repentance goes, the emphasis is on us in terms of number of texts. When you get to believe, there are more texts which say that God gives faith, but equally there are a majority that say he commands faith, and we are told we must produce it. When we get to baptism, there is more about what God does in baptism and less about what we are doing. And finally, when it comes to receiving the Holy Spirit, God is doing most of it. And yet we are commanded to receive, but they are a minority of texts. So there's a kind of growing emphasis on God doing the saving and a declining emphasis on man doing it. Does that make sense to you? That's purely the number of texts, verses, that talk about each of the four steps. And so there's a gradual emphasis away from what man does and more emphasis on what God does as we go through the four steps. Hope that's made a bit of sense. Which brings me to the second major theological issue. And this I call the inevitability of the four steps. In other words, once you've started on the way of salvation, is it inevitable that you will finish? Or could something go wrong? To put it another way, at what point are we safe from hell? And one of the list of questions I've been given is, at what point in the four steps has something happened that can't be undone? Are we guaranteed a place in heaven? Or can we lose our salvation? That's a huge issue. Now, for the people who believe it's all of God, there's no issue. They believe that if God has chosen us, he will see it through and will get us into heaven. That once you've started being saved, you will inevitably go on until it's all complete. John Bunyan was not of that view, and in Pilgrim's Progress, he has Pilgrim and his friend on the shores of the River Jordan, beyond which they can see the celestial city that they've been making for. And Pilgrim's friend can't face the River Jordan and says, I'm going to find another way. And he turns off to the side and goes down a path along the river bank. And Bunyan writes, and so I saw in my dream that there is a road to hell, even from the gates of heaven. And very few people have noticed that in his book. It's a profound thought that you can get to the gates of heaven and still find another way off the road that leads you there. Now, why do I believe, therefore, that you can lose your salvation? You can lose what you've got, Mind you, if you'd understood what I've said so far, you haven't even got it at all yet. But can you lose what you have got? And my answer is clearly, yes, you can. And I wish that more Christians were told this and warned that you can get off the way. You can turn off the road that leads to heaven. Now, why do I believe that? Well, first, because there are 80 passages in the New Testament which warn you not to lose what you've got and warn you about the other possibilities. 80 passages by every writer of the New Testament in different places. Let's just go through some of them. If I went through 80, you'd be here till midnight. But I'll pick out some to show you what there is. First of all, on the lips of Jesus, the parable of the sower in Mark 4. And there he says that some seed fell on the pathway and never germinated, never got started. But other seed fell on shallow ground and it sprang up and began to grow. Now that to me is a clear statement that the gospel has been received. But it couldn't go on growing because the soil was too shallow. Others failed to grow up for other reasons, choked by weeds, by the cares of this world, said Jesus, and the concerns that people shouldn't have, and that can crush the new life of the kingdom. Only that which fell on good ground, which germinates and grows up and becomes 30, 60, and 100-fold. That's ensuring a good harvest. That's one thing Jesus said, that the seed which we sow, the word of the kingdom, isn't all going to grow. And it will depend on the kind of soil in people's hearts, whether it does. And it can even grow for a time and then fail. But let's look at something more direct in John 15, where Jesus says, abide in me, stay in me, reside in me. He said, branches don't have life in themselves. They only have life as they stay in the vine. And therefore, when we come to Christ, we don't have eternal life in a package and say, I've got eternal life, but I have life as I stay in Christ. He is the source of eternal life. And as I abide in him, that life flows into mine. And he said, if you don't abide in me, you will be cut off, you will become fruitless, and you will be burned in the fire. That's as strong as I remember Jesus speaking on this issue. Cut off, burned in the fire, and that's a branch in the vine that happened to him. Let's move on to Romans chapter 11, which is the key chapter to the whole letter. And there Paul talks about Jews who failed to go on believing. They got out of Egypt believing in God, And then they face the wilderness and they stop believing in God. They could have been in the promised land in less than a fortnight, but they were 40 years wandering around the desert because they didn't believe that God could get them in. And so the New Testament says, learn from them. They all set out from Egypt. Only two of them got into the promised land through lack of faith. They believed to get out, but they didn't believe to get in. And he says, that's a lesson to believers today. Not all who start off the journey make it to the end. Indeed, it could only be a minority that make it to the end. It's a hard road. It's a narrow road. And few stay with it. There's a broad road that the world wants you to travel. And it's easy to find out, easy to drift into it. And so there comes a very bit of straight talk. Paul says, just as the Jews were cut off when they stopped believing, you too will be cut off if you do not continue in God's kindness. Now that's as clear a passage, but I've never heard it read in church. I've never heard it preached on. And yet it's in Paul's letter to the Romans, which is supposed to be so popular. Let's move on. 1 Corinthians 15. Paul says, I gave you the gospel that I believed, a gospel that Jesus died for our sins, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scripture. Now he says, that's what I taught you. That's what you received. That's what you believed. And it will save you and get you there if you go on believing it. If you hold on to the truth I gave you, you'll get there. And the little word if there is all important. If you hold on to the truth, it's not a matter of grasping the truth, it's hanging in there, holding on to it, and then you'll arrive. Galatians 4 talks about falling from grace. Grace saves you, yes, but it's not irresistible. You can fall from grace, and it's no longer part of your life. Hebrews chapter 6, where the writer says, if you turn away from Christ, there is no repentance possible. You can't come back. Very strong word. And Hebrews chapter 10 is even stronger. So strong that I want to read it to you. Very strong word. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment that will consume the enemies of God. Talks about those who trample the Son of God underfoot. Read the passage for yourself. It's clear that's Hebrews 6 and Hebrews 10. I'm only picking up one or two of the 80 I could have picked up. 2 Peter 2 is one of the strongest. And again, I'll read it to you because it's the Word of God. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in it and overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and to turn their backs on the sacred commandment that was passed on to them. Of them the proverbs are true, a dog returns to his vomit, and a sow that is washed goes back to her wallowing in the mud. Strong language. Again, I hope you've heard that preached because it's part of the Word of God. That once you've escaped the corruption of the world through knowing the Savior and then find yourself entangled back in it, it's like a dog going back to its vomit or a pig going back to the mud. These are real possibilities. The first letter of John talks about if a brother sins, pray for him. But he then adds, there is a sin that leads to death. Do not pray for him. And so there are some sins you can pray about, and there's some other sins that you cannot pray about. Finally, in the book of Revelation, there's the book of life. And the letter to Sardis talks about having your name scrubbed out of the book of life. Now, we say blotted out because we write in ink. They wrote on vellum or parchment with a scratchy pen that made a mark on the paper, and the ink fell into the mark. And the way of erasing that was to take a penknife and scrape that bit of the parchment clean. And the literal word there is that your name will not be scraped off the book of life. Now, the book of life is mentioned 4 times in the Bible, Old and New Testament. And of those 4 times, 3 are talking about the possibility of your name being blotted out or scraped off. 3/4 of the text mentioning the book of life are warning that your name can be removed from it. And when we get to the day when books are open, the day of final judgment, we want our name in that book. It must still be there. And yet Jesus threatens with the removal of that name. Now, the word confident is important here because a number of texts in the New Testament have been quoted as promises that you will make it. Take one text. He who began a good work in you will continue and complete it against that day. Have you heard that text? But I haven't quoted the whole text. The first part of the text says, Paul is writing, I am confident that he who began a good work in you will continue and complete it against that day. He says, I'm confident. Or take Hebrews 6, having described that people who fall from Christ can't repent and find their way back, the writer says, I am confident that this will not happen to you. Now, when Paul, or the writer of the Hebrews, says, I am confident, he is not saying, I am absolutely sure. He is saying, in your case, I am confident this will not happen to you. Because it did happen to many. Some made shipwreck of their faith. Others backslid. And so when Paul says, I'm confident that in your case, this won't happen, he will complete what he's begun. And when Hebrews says, I am confident in your case that you will not fall away from Christ and deny him publicly, they're expressing confidence of the kind that a teacher in a school parents meeting would say, I'm confident your son is going to pass the exam. It's not saying I'm certain. It's saying, knowing your son, I'm confident that he'll make it. So these texts, and there are many others, which express confidence that someone will make it, are based on their knowledge of the person, not on the knowledge of God. I'm confident in your case, you're going to make it. You are traveling so well, you are doing so well. I'm confident you'll get there. So don't turn those confident texts into promises that apply to every Christian. They don't. And the last thing I want to say is this. The four steps are not one-off. We need to continue repentance. And 1 John says, if we go on confessing our sins, he is righteous and will forgive, and will go on forgiving our sins, and the blood of Christ will go on cleansing us from all unrighteousness. And we need to go on believing. Not just believing once. It's a life of faith that saves. And says Paul, the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God. And it's not me who is living now. It's Christ who is living in me. Now, baptism in water is never repeated. That does not need to go on. I know that many people would love to go on being baptized. They feel so clean. And when they get dirty again, they want to get clean again. And they want to keep on being bathed and buried. But no, that is a one-off. And likewise, baptism in the Spirit is never repeated. But being filled with the Spirit is. So all these things have a continuing effect on the Christian life. And if we stay faithful to these four things, we're going to make it to heaven. I'm a bit nearer there than you are, I think. But I look forward to meeting you there. Amen.